Tonight, more than a billion people will go to bed hungry. Within the next 30 to 40 years, that number may double. The availability of food to individuals is a complex issue. It's not just a case of producing more. The food that is produced has to be distributed. The price, of course, is important to people. These are all considerations that determine who eats what and how much they have to eat.
Climate change and food security are intimately linked, both within Europe in the sense of how good we are in Europe to develop our own food resources, but also internationally. Our intensification or extensification of agriculture has a direct and indirect effects on the use of land outside of Europe, the use of water internationally, which also impacts directly on the lives, poverty and wealth of people abroad.
In any given situation, people may be barred from accessing food rather than actually not being provided for. Land is destroyed, or indeed that their wages are so low that they can't buy the food that they require.
There's normally competition, especially for land, between agriculture and conservation. So the question has been, how do you promote agricultural productivity in order to obviously address problems of food security while not doing any harm to the environment?
I have worked in Amazon for a long time. There are 60 different environmental or natural resource categories reflected in the maps that indigenous people are using about natural resource management and how to improve governance of their own territories.
One of the compounds we're particularly interested in is jasmonic acid. This compound does a whole range of things in the plant. It enables it to change the cell wall structure, that means it's more difficult to eat by pests, but it also enables the plant to create chemicals that should a pest actually eat the plant, it's put off from eating any more of it.
Okay, well, the main species that we're working on is the African armyworm. It's a small caterpillar, about 3 or 4 centimetres long, but they can reach densities in excess of 1,000 per square metre. So really high densities can destroy crops like maize, wheat, sorghum, millet, all the staple crops in Africa. So what we're doing is to use a natural virus of the caterpillar. It's a virus that is found in the field anyway, but in small amounts. So what we do is to collect that virus and spray it onto the crop when the caterpillars are on there, kills the caterpillars within a few days, so increasing the yield of the crop.
You'd think you were on a different planet. I mean, these are not grown in soil, they're grown in an artificial medium, they're grown with an artificial nutrient solution, they're grown using integrated pest management, and they have a very efficient energy management system in the glasshouse. So, you know, that's all crop science, which has developed from fundamental plant science, which has been done in places like Lancaster University over the last 20 years or so. Lancaster's still a relatively young university. We're not quite 50 years old, but we can look back on some considerable success.
Well, the work at Lancaster, the degree course and the PhD course, taught me the basics of the experimental work behind environmental information and knowledge, as well as the field work behind it, so that it gave the fundament to my work today.
My employer, they asked me to work in Cameron Highlands because Cameron Highlands have many problems in the environment.
During my study in Lancaster, I was engaged in R&D, and I can apply it in here, in the lab and in the field.
We compare vegetable, planted in the open farm, and also cultivation under the rain shelter compared with the tea. And the tea plantation is the most sustainable agriculture. It's good to control soil erosion.
So we have a research here with researchers from various countries. We have working with the studies in salinity and upland rice, exploring all the information that relate plant metabolism to environmental stresses. The experience in Lancaster, actually, especially in terms of research culture that developed with the laboratory in Lancaster, is really fantastic.
I greatly appreciate Lancaster and the working environment there, because it's a very friendly and supportive environment, and that experience helped me to lay the basic foundation as a scientist. And on that foundation, I built a lot of areas relating to food security. We have problems here. We are looking for disease resistant, drought tolerant, and high yielding varieties.
But I was very impressed by the five-day course I was at Windermere. One particular thing I like about this course is that it's a course that also gives you a chance to tell them or to do a feedback in terms of what you learned, how are you going to apply it in the field.
We're a family-owned business called Sunripe that started farming in 65 in Kenya, started our first exports in 69, and we now export to 25 countries throughout the world. And we're on one of our organic farms that in Naivasha that John manages. John looks after 500 hectares of land in this area.
This is a 10,000 hectare conservancy where there are three things: cattle, wild animals, and horticulture. From a macro point of view, we want to see that diversity. We want to see horticulture side by side, wild animals side by side, other activities like the wetland making, so that the environment is conserved for crop production and also for support of the biodiversity.
The next generation, they're going to have at their fingertips some remarkable tools that we didn't have when I was growing up. And they're going to have a range of molecular tools, biotechnology tools. They're also getting training, particularly a place like Lancaster, of interdisciplinary research.
I had to come here to Lancaster, actually, to discover this new modern techniques in plant physiology and plant horticulture, because it wasn't possible to do it in Egypt on that time. And now I'm going back to Egypt carrying this new information for the whole population.
They're going to receive the training in, now, how do you do social science studies? How do you do high quality molecular science? How do you do high quality field science? And it's going to be difficult, but it's the next generation that are going to find it easier to do, because they're going to be brought up with that methodology.
I think Lancaster needs to try to engage both with students in the UK, because I think there are still issues for food production in this country, because we are so reliant on food from elsewhere. But also it's about, in a sense, teaching the teachers. It's training other students that are able then to go back to their home countries, that can deliver the advice, the information to their own governments, potentially, and they can have an impact on policy. Certainly some of the things we've been doing with China, I think we're seeing that happening already.
This international collaboration can't just be an instance of the one-off shared workshop. You know, a trip to Beijing or to Nairobi for a week or so. It has to be the development of long-term partnerships where there are real contributions from both sides in the building of learning.
For young students, I think if they're really interested in this those issues, I think they really need to go to the field to have a look at the realities. What is really happening in the field, exchange students, it's very important.
So we send our students at least for 3 months to developing countries to conduct their research for their dissertation there. Basically community-based ecotourism, which is one of the projects Kenvo has evolved as a way of promoting both agriculture and environmental sustainability.
My own experience is that it was not the science only that worked here. I think I had even to develop what I would call community science. I had to develop these tricks of dealing with politicians and local leaders and all that.
If you teach young people to look at things in a systemic way, in an integrated way, they'll take that through their career. If you teach them to look at things only in a unidisciplinary way, they'll take that through their career as well. And today's problem are synergistic and integrated. So it's vitally important that young people do their research, do their training in an integrated, interdisciplinary fashion from the very beginning.
If you connect everything, particularly livelihood, and particularly the social aspect, you can make a headway.
Our environment, every environment is very local. So you can come up with a global idea, but then you have to localize it. So we've got to come up with the best ideas that are applicable for our environment, for any environment that we're going to work in, and give them a commercial angle so that it's taken on and remains sustainable.
Farmers have an inherent knowledge of their crops. The proportion that are actually nearing retirement, and we have their children that are leaving farms. So a lot of that knowledge that's been there for generation after generation is beginning to be lost.
A whole global shift that is going on forces a very different agenda on the social sciences, not just to move beyond a sort of European, North American focus to incorporate these other parts of the world and the problems they face and scholars from this part of these other parts of the world, but also to understand what the integration of these countries will have on the food system and on food security. That's going to be an absolutely essential agenda, and one which I think will take a lot longer than the next 5 years to bottom out.
I think the next generation of students in environmental sciences have really got to look at the interactions between all the parts of the socioeconomic system, not just look at environment on its own. We've got to look the way in which human behaviour even interacts with the way in which we generate welfare for ourselves.
I feel passionately that if we don't do it now, it's going to be extremely difficult for a lot of people.